Good evening, everybody. My name is Simon Wright. I am the Director of Programming here at Japan House London. And welcome to today's event, Toasting the Recovery of Tohoku's Sake Industry. This is the second talk event organized as part of Tohoku 311, Forward to the Future, a series in which we are collaborating with the Reconstruction Agency in Japan. In this session, as part of a series of events looking at the revitalization initiatives in the Tohoku region of northeastern Japan, we explore how sake breweries in Iwate, Miyagi, and Fukushima prefectures have overcome the challenges brought on by the Great East Japan earthquake in 2011, and successfully back on track, focusing on selected producers in these prefectures and tracing the path of their recovery. Today we are broadcasting live from Japan House in front of a live physical audience and also a live virtual audience on Zoom, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn. This event is being recorded, and a recording of it will be archived on our social media platforms following the event. There'll be two presentations, followed by an opportunity to take questions from the audience afterwards. If you have a question, please feel free to ask it in the question and answer session at the end. And for those of you joining on Zoom, please submit your questions at any time using the Q&A function. So now I would like to welcome today's first speaker, Yoshitake Rie. She is a UK-Japan communication consultant and a leading sake ambassador in Europe, where she represents the Japan Sake and Shochu Makers Association, Sake Samurai Association, and the International Wine Challenge Sake Competition. Will you please join me in welcoming Yoshitake Rie?
Good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for the introduction, Kai. So, 11 years, time flies, but memory stays just like yesterday. We all remember so clearly what happened. On that particular day in London, we were so devastated and sad and almost at a loss without knowing what to do, how to help Tohoku. And I remember we started drinking sake for Tohoku, to support Tohoku. Yes, sake became the symbols of the Tohoku recovery because sake is the oldest industry in Japan and the spirit of Japanese people in the Tohoku area too. So, world got together to support and drank sake because it joins the heart of people together. To reciprocate this world kindness, sake makers in Tohoku who are devastated and you can imagine in the unbelievable, unimaginable hardship, they strived in the adversities and recovered from the disaster. They didn't just recover, but they stood up and now leading the industry and the region just like a spearhead and moving forward for the bright future. So I'm very proud to introduce some remarkable stories of amazing sake makers today, who contributed greatly for the great recovery of Tohoku. So let's start from the Miyagi Prefecture, which is the closest to the epicenter of the earthquake, do you remember? I would like to introduce Nizawa Brewery, who were devastated and completely destroyed by the earthquake. Thank you.
災で歴史を失って蔵を失って人だけが残ってで多分こう強さを見つけた僕らはこうそんなに弱くないっていうあの時は本当にこんな力が出せるんだなっていうぐらい今振り返ってもじっとしてても明日は変わらない、まず昨日と同じことはしない、そのせっかく与えられた一日だから昨日より何か進化しないといけない、それが窮地に追い込まれてから変わらなきゃっていうんじゃなくて僕らは常に変わらなきゃいけないって思わなきゃ、
So what a powerful message from Niizawa-san. He says we must keep moving for the better. Today is not yesterday. We must be better. So he was devastated by the total destruction of the sake maker. But he moved 8 kilometers to the new site with a new team. And he kept making two brands.At Agonomatsu and Hakurakse. For Niizawa-san, the challenge was to create a new environment for the new sake industry. For that, he actually introduced, well, let's say, abolished the kind of tranquility, I mean, old-fashioned Japanese sake industry's ethos.Which rely on the seniority and also gender, men. But anyway, the young team was encouraged to improve their palate every day. So as they come to the brewery, they drank, tested about 60 bottles of sake every day. Can you imagine? So every day they try to improve for the better sake.And also, Niizawa-san introduced 22-year-old woman Toji as the head of the brewery. This was unthinkable in the old Japanese sake industry. But can you imagine, because of this precedence, now we have about 50 lady Tojis in Japan. So he set the new precedent.Of course, he didn't fail to produce the super premium sake, which is very proud to do export. And the Hakurakse Zankyo, this is the super polished down sake, up to 7%. Can you imagine from the grain of the 100% rice to polish to 7% in order to make the premium sake? And it took actually 350 hours, 2 weeks continuously running the polishing machine. You can imagine how tiring and expensive. But because of this unbelievable success, his sake was introduced to the world. And also many people started doing, competing the 7%. And now we have even next to 0% ratio for the polishing rate.So moving to Hakurakse, I would also like to introduce you Urakasumi Sake Brewery in Miyagi Prefecture. The Urakasumi is just near the most beautiful bay called Matsushima, one of the three most beautiful sites. And obviously, this place was destroyed by the tsunami. So, Urakatsumi, Mr. Sawa, the founder, the 13th generation sake maker, is now exploring not only sake tourism, but something called philantourism, together with the team of the Miyagi prefecture. That means, philantourism means to invite tourists to help the problem, to solve the issues of the local people, to become the kind of temporary local, to be the part of the family, and to help the locals. So what it means, Urakatsumi has a field in the middle of the island is Matsushima called Sabusawa, and they make sake. So in order to make the rice, this island had a problem of aging population and also didn't have enough workforce. So people, tourists, came from even overseas to work together to become a local and produce the sake. And not only that, Matsushima Bay is very well known for oysters, beautiful oysters, and they work together with the local fishermen and also enjoy the delicacy of the sea. So this includes all local, regional sort of, you know, build up, and it was very successful. I couldn't introduce everybody, but there is another sake maker called Sasaki Shizuo, who was also very much destroyed by tsunami itself, wiped, but it's also stood up strongly and making the really wonderful sake. So that was Miyagi Prefecture. Then I would like to move to Iwate, which is north of Miyagi Prefecture. And here, I would like to focus on the man who is known having the biggest smile on the earth, called Kuji-san, Kuji Kosuke, from Nambu Bijin. Let's hear what he did. So his smile is very contagious. Actually, the song, The Time to Say Goodbye, I think it means time to say goodbye to tears, but say hello to the world. So this is the one Mr. Kuji gave the biggest smile through the video, because he won the 2017, he won the world's biggest sake competition. Beating off like 1,500 sake makers, can you imagine? And obviously, he was so proud for his achievement for the Iwate and the Tohoku. Very well done. What he Kujisan is famous for is when the earthquake happened, what the Japanese government asked the Japanese people is to refrain from drinking. Just like a pandemic, we do the same, you know, alcohol, something you should give up when having a hard time. Then obviously that suffered economy completely. So Kujisan stood up and all the YouTube, using the YouTube and saying, please, please don't stop drinking. Drink more sake to help Osaka, to help the Tohoku economy. And that movement spread. I'm sure this is why the reason why we drank sake even overseas. So after that, he decided to go abroad, and he says, if we wanted to, you know, let the people to drink, I must get the real passport to go there. What it meant was, the population of the 20% of the world population is actually Jewish community, and he thought he has to get the kosher certified sake. So he introduced the kosher sake 2013, immediately after the disaster. Then after that, he also gets the vegan certified sake. It is only a couple of years ago. But many people still think sake is vegan anyway. Actually, it is not. Because sake, especially the mass production sake, we use gelatin, which is the extract of the animal. So obviously, he stopped using that. He doesn't need to use that. So that's a really great achievement. And there are so many people following him. As a result, of course, have a look. His country, the exporting countries, thrived from 21 countries to 55 after 10 years of the disaster. Then the volume, export volume, became four times higher. Mind you, Japanese industry is still diminishing, but showing this result is just amazing. Okay, now I come to Fukushima, the last prefecture, which I would like to introduce Yamatogawa as a sake maker, but it's, I also wanted to introduce a small video which I visited about 10 years ago. So let's share that.
Something elegant and never get bored with, and you feel like drinking again and again. I'm here in Fukushima today. I hear there are lots of beautiful sake in this county, and I would like to find out with you. Fukushima is located about 200 kilometers to the north of Tokyo. There are over 50 sake makers in the prefecture. Now at Weasuyahiro Brewery, one of the most famous sake maker in Aizu Wakamatsu City.
我が社は1850年、ちょうど166年目を迎えました。積極的な技術の革新取り入れを行ってきて、 そしてお米に対しても地元の農家100軒の方と契約栽培をして、とにかくお米にこだわってきてます。いただきます。はい。This
has much higher acidity and more complexity. So you can't drink this anywhere else, but here you have to come here. I'm here at the oldest sake maker in Kitakata, and surrounded by water again.
また一致して、こうやって常に感謝するんですね。
It's a treasure, 宝ですね。 宝。 For you, it is your life.
米のジュースと言ってもいいかも。
Oh, you call it the rice juice. Oh, this is light.
海外に持ってくとね、みんなびっくりするのは、なんであのこのライス米からこんなに素敵な香りや味が出るんだと、ミラクルだってみんな驚いてくれますよね。
I'm here, the champion of the International Wine Challenge 2015, Homare Shuzo. What changed you after having the number one sake champion?
Also, many like visitors came to our brewery. They taste. They want to taste the champion sake.
Of course.
But it ran out already. So
oh,
everybody.
Really?
Yeah. I'm sorry. It's gone already. So.
I'm here to taste your number one sake champion here today.
I'm sorry.
Today.
Maybe next year.
Oh my goodness! I have to come back again.
It's kind of a unique one, and we are mixing a Nigori sake, this one, and strawberry juice. Natural strawberry juice.
Is it your invention?
Yes.
This is amazing, excitement of the sake selection, isn't it?
Thank you.
Now I'm at Daishichi Brewery. It is such an impressively modern building, but the inside is quite traditional, and they actually make very old-fashioned sake. It's very fresh and aromatic. Definitely, these sake are beyond Japanese food. It is very important for the future of sake. It is.
放射能に関してのものは基準値を我々自身が設けてますから、そこで一切検出されたことありませんし、安心して飲んでいただきたいというふうに思ってます。
I think Fukushima sake is just amazing. It is not really well known, even by a sake specialist like myself, that Fukushima can offer so many different types of sake. So, in one word, I only have to say, Fukushima is a sake wonderland. It's the finest sake, home of the finest sake, and it has to be yet to be discovered.
Thank you for watching. As you know, Fukushima is the hardest hit in many ways because of the nuclear meltdown, and they suffered a lot. But because of that, they created incredible solidarity. I think it is there are 63 sake makers in Fukushima. They were not necessarily the all good friends before, but now they got all together for the one purpose to create to recovery for Fukushima. So there were also team, I mean, the people behind that for this success, and Mr. Suzuki from the Sake Research Center, he was giving the technology and all the advice to the sake maker to produce the better sake. And of course, governor, wonderful governor, Uchimura-san, Uchibori, has led the team to work hard. So the solidarity of the Fukushima was the success of the Fukushima sake. And as we said in the film, there were two sake champion, IWC sake, International Wine Challenge sake champions, who was, the left one was Homare Shuzo 2015, Mr. Karahashi, who was the one who sold out all the sake before I came in the film. And also Okunomatsu, Mr. Yusa, who actually, you know, won the greatest sake again. So two sake makers contributed a lot to raise the profile of sake in the worldwide. And more than anything else, I think, Fukushima's greatest achievement is that they won 8 times continuously, consecutively, since the 2012, it is just easy. Immediately after the earthquake, they won through the 8th number one of Japan's most dignified 100 years old history of the sake competition. How wonderful it was, and Mr. Uchibori is celebrating together. And this was a very rare additional newspaper, which was published immediately after the announcement. So it's a lot of power, I mean, the jointly achieved solidarity in Fukushima, that was really amazing. And now I wanted to focus on the one gentleman, and he's a sake maker, but who is now contributing about the sustainability, SDGs, in the industry of the Fukushima. Immediately after the disaster, he started thinking, we cannot rely on the nuclear energy anymore. So he built the electric power company in that region, in the Iwate electric power company, and now supplying the electricity as well as sake. So it's amazing. So almost to conclude why Tohoku sake is so good is just like the one which I mentioned. They are using the local water, pure local underground water from the mountain, and also very rich soil producing the various sake rice. And plus, they are using the sustainable energies and the people, labors. So no wonder sake is now contributing to the recovery of the region. I hope you understand that one. So all locally resourced. So this is almost the end of my seminar. But as I just wanted to say lastly, there are over 250 sake makers in Tohoku itself. They are all suffered without any exception. They really had a hard time, and they recovered. And they are the real heroes of Japan, and I hope you agree. And today, we would like to celebrate their contribution and success. And we would like to toast for the future, of the bright future of the Tohoku later together. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Yoshitake-san, for your presentation. And I know that you'll be joining us later for the question and answer session. So if you have any questions for Yoshitake-san, please do start thinking of them now. Or if you're watching online, please do send them through. I would now like to welcome our second speaker for this evening, Tasaka Asami. So she is a sake sommelier and the managing director at World Sake Imports UK. World Sake Imports supplies sake to over 100 high-end restaurants throughout the country. And she played a key role in the growth of sake sales in New York City for World Sake Imports and helped to foster the sake boom there. She moved to London and opened the UK market in 2008, and she is a panel chair of the IWC sake competition. Currently, Tasaka-san is focusing on building a retail and online business to cope with the new environment which we find ourselves in today. Thank you, Tasaka-san. Thank you. During the presentation, she is going to introduce three sake, I believe, yes? One from each of the three prefectures of Iwate, Miyagi, and Fukushima. And for our guests who are attending here in the room, we are delighted to be able to offer you tastings. Our staff will come and serve you. Please remember, you must be 18 years of age to take part, and we operate a Challenge 25 policy. But over to you, Tasaka-san, if I may. Thank you very much. Please join me in welcoming you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm sure hearing such a beautiful presentation from Ms. Yoshitake, You are thirsty, I hope. Pretty nice. So today I will explain about the three sake, and then all of the sake using their local rice. And I think in Tohoku region, I think the sake brewery would like to support local farmers as well as having the local delicacy. And of course, the local delicacy will come from the local ingredients. And this hakurakusei from Miyagi Prefecture is using kuranohana rice. Is the other kuranohana sake rice. You know, sake is using sake rice, not the eating rice. Did you know? Yes? Yes. So the normally eating rice is for eating, and it contains little different components, and in sake rice is a special rice. And having a local sake rice is easy to say, but it's very difficult to achieve. And this kuranohana sake rice took about 7 years to develop. So, and then after that, it became one of the best sake rice that are found in Tohoku region. And this sake is just fried in from Japan last week, wasn't it? And then this is freshly pressed sake. Sake is normally made in the winter time, and then freshly pressed sake release around now. And they just flow into for this event, maybe, so that the we could enjoy this very fresh, young characteristic of sake. When you smell, you can smell this. I know it's the cup to you, so the aroma may be a little bit different than the me, but you might taste much more green, you know, the like kiwi or the green grapes, you know, this very young, fresh character. And that's the character you will taste when you go to the brewery and then smell inside after the sake is made. And then you smell the freshly pressed sake. And this is the aroma, the closest aroma you could get. So I think it's quite fun to taste today, no? And hakurakusei, of course, make the one of the best beautiful sake. And can you imagine this one is made by now 25 years old female brewmaster. And I think she achieved an incredible job to make such a beautiful sake. And what do you think? It's good? So I'd like to have a little comment from Simon-san, Mr. Simon.
I've been asked to stand up.
What do you think about this?
But I'm no expert in sake at all, as you know.
That's the perfect comment that we.
I know very little. But what I can tell is, I mean, because I find it sometimes quite difficult to drink sake.
Yes.
I mean, I've admitted this to you. But this is quite dry, isn't it?
Yes.
And it's quite crisp, isn't it?
So very.
That's more suitable for me than the ones which are a lot smoother.
Yeah. So. You think you can be liking sake more now? Getting there.
Maybe with your help.
Yeah, it's quite dry, sharp aftertaste and make it.
It's the dryness which I like.
Yeah, it doesn't go away. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So this dry, clean sake, and of course it has a beautiful fruity note. It goes quite nicely with carpaccio, ceviche. It doesn't have to be sashimi or sushi. I mean, it would definitely would go quite nicely with sushi and sashimi, but it would go quite beautifully with the other more European style, or ceviche is not European, but still, it's much more easy to get here. And then this sake is available upstairs too, so you can enjoy it at home. Yes? Let me go into the next one. So the next sake, it's called Yauemon, okay, from Fukushima Prefecture. So it's coming. Good. So and if you have a sake, please keep a little bit left so that you can go back and compare I know, yes, it's the first sake, but you finished it. It's okay if you finished it. Sorry, I forgot to mention it to you earlier. So, but it's always nice to compare one or two sake when you're having sake at home, even. Once you open the sake, you can keep it, most of sake, about 2 weeks. So if you buy open two bottles, you will have a 2 weeks to finish in two. I mean, two bottles is really not that much sake. So, and then so this Yaoemon, as the other Miss Yoshitake said, they like to use all the local produce. Again, this one is using the other Yume no Kaori. It's the other sake rice. Grown, produced in Fukushima prefecture. So, and then of course the water. This brewery is located in the mountainside, so more inland of the Fukushima prefecture. So the water is quite soft. It has a slight bit of the minerality, but still quite very soft water coming from the mountain. But when you drink this, you see the character is very different. This one is a little bit more matured, so that the first one was very young, greenish character. Now here, it has a little bit more banana or a round, creamy character. And when you drink it, it's quite big, bone dry, and drying your mouth quite strongly, no? Do you agree? Do you like it? Very nice. So this is the character you want, something a little bit more oily. To me, you can do fish and chips. That'd be nice. And then grilled fish. So I would not, I can, you can try with sashimi, no problem. But the other, I like it with more fatty or oily or more cooked. Croquette will be quite nice as well. So many of the food that you eat will be quite good as well. And then the brewery also suggested the cheese. So maybe fresh cheese or goat cheese. I haven't tried it yet, but you can try and see how it goes. So yeah, I'd like to hear some comment from Miss Yoshitake, if you can. Because she's also the pro of the tasting. Sorry, this is not
okay. Well, this is a gentleman who actually creating the electricity, if you remember. But it's, when I tasted this one, I remember his also comment. It's like a sake, it's like a rice juice. It's so pure. You can feel the water itself from the mountain, and also it's not like a wine to, you know, attack your nose. It's not what you can find it in sake, but it's such a purity. Mm. And but it has a body, its voluptuousness compared to the last one. So you can take the rich food, not only Japanese, but it's a, as Asami said, it's a quite a, you know, oily food as well. But it's a, such a beautiful sake. Thank you.
You finish it.
I have already.
Yeah. So yeah. Today's sake actually quite interestingly, all the rice is polished down to 55%. But you see how much character is different. So each different kind of, different producer producing different type of sake, and even though the similar taste. Is in there. Okay. So let me move on to our champion sake. So the next sake is called Number Vision. The other Miss Yoshitake was saying that the they won the other champion from the International Wine Challenge. And on the picture that she was showing you had an old label. But this is exactly the same sake, but they changed the label to very modern, more beautiful looking, you know, more 2022 size. And So this one won the champion sake from 1,245 sake. So we had to do, I did the judging as well, and we had to do the judging of 1,245 kinds of sake. And then we have to choose one, the best. And this was the best in 2017. So you can tell the sake is a little bit more floral. Again, it's kind of greenish character. Maybe a little bit of apple, melon, that's kind of fruity aromas coming up. And kiwi, maybe, like a green melon, yeah? So beautiful kind of fruity aroma, but so silky and creamy, soft character. It's fairly light, but still, it's really easy, smooth drinking sake. And then it has a beautiful acidity too. So yeah, do you like it? Very nice. Would you give champion to this sake? Yes? Good. I like all of the sake, but this one particularly has such a beautiful smooth texture. And then quite gentle and soft by itself would be quite nice too. So, you can pair very nicely with more traditional Japanese food to me. So you can do teriyaki chicken, which is easy to make at home, right? And salmon will be quite good, and so on. So dashi or sashimi, traditional Japanese food, I would go quite nicely with this one. I'd like to hear your opinion about this sake from the audience. Would you give a little volunteer? Yes, please. Yeah, exactly. It's not set up at all.
Yeah, no, not at all.
Not at all. So what do you think?
The third one for me has a bit of like a licorice aftertaste that's coming through really strongly.
Yeah, definitely.
But yeah, the warmth of it compared to the first one is really nice.
Yeah. Do you like it?
Absolutely.
Which one is your favorite?
Personally, I really like the second one that we tried.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it kind
you
of...
Like bond, right?
Yeah, it kind of like is almost syrupy, like olive oil. And the apricot really came through on that one.
What a wonderful comment. You're like, whoa. Thank you.
You're very
thank
welcome.
You very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So, thank you. So, those are the three sakes. And thank you very much for listening to my sake talk, and then I hope you liked all of them. And we would go, I guess, to the Q&A, so see you later. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tasaka-san. I hope you've enjoyed your tastes of sake so far. I'm still learning. We're about to go into the question and answer session, so Yoshitake-san will be joining us from before, and Tasaka-san will also join us. Where am I? I'll be here, shall I? Thank you. Please, Yoshitake-san. Yes, yes, yes. Okay. We finished all yours, just take a second.
We need a little more sake. Yeah, I think we need more sake.
So we're open to the floor. If anybody, yes, we do have somebody already. Thank you. Keep your hand up if you would, please. Could you keep your hand up so that we will get a microphone to you, so that the people online can hear. If you keep your hand up, please. Thank you.
Could you bring some water for me, please?
Thank you. I was curious about this issue of gelatin. I was wondering if you could say a bit more about the use of gelatin in the production of sake. I wasn't familiar that it was used, and also for that particular brewery, what they're using to supplement, since they're no longer using an animal product to make it vegan. Thank you.
I really didn't.
Okay, no. For those of you who couldn't hear, it was a question about the use of gelatin, and maybe you could give us some more information about that particular brewery and how they changed. Yes.
No, I was kind of expecting that they would ask if sake is vegan or not, but I said gelatin is not only the way. I mean, you know, when you finish, the wine is the same. They use the white. Egg white for the refining and put the all the lead in the bottom to separate. So sake does at the same time, and for that they used to use the white. Still, some of them are using the gelatin, but now people like Nambu Bijin, who applied the vegan, they don't use it at all. So it is possible. Especially the sake we had, I don't think they are gelatin used at all. So, but the problem is that although sake can be vegan certified, but they need to apply to say this is vegan certified. So you know it is a bit difficult for the vegan people to choose sake. But it's, I have to say most of them are vegan friendly.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your question. Do we have any more questions in the room at the moment? We do, yes. Thank you very much. Thank you. If you could speak into the microphone so that the people online can hear as well.
I'll do my best.
Thank you.
This is my ignorance, but I was not aware about different percentages of polish of rice which they do for brewing sake. Could you explore that a little bit and what difference does it make if they polish rice more?
Who would like to answer that about polishing rice?
Would you like?
Yes.
Okay. Tasaka-san, thank you. Thank you.
So the brown rice is the little brown husk in the rice. So that's very difficult to make sake with because the husk is not really suitable for making the good sake. So there is brown rice sake, but we need to remove the outside of the sake rice. And then the more we remove, we are going to be in the, reaching into the center of sake rice. And center of sake rice, there is a pure starch. And pure starch is the one converting into sugar. And sugar eat the yeast eat the sugar produce alcohol. So that what we want is the pure starch. And the outer layer of the sake rice, it has more protein fat, which it will become more of the umami. You know, are you familiar with umami? More rich, quite full taste. So that the if we want to have a umami rich sake, we don't remove too much. But we would remove maybe about 10 to 20%. And then if we want to make sake that is more fruity, floral, like the one that we tried today, more elegant style, then we would remove the outer layer of the sake rice to 45% using 55%. So some of them, 7% polishing ratio, that means they are removing most of the protein fat using the pure starch that make the sake much more elegant and smooth and fruity. So that's good.
May I just add something?
Less umami, yes.
Sadly, something you got to know about the sake when you choose is polishing ratio, because the price also referred, influenced by the polishing ratio, how much you polish it down, as Asami said. Usually, sake, the more you polish the outside unwanted place, the sake becomes more refiner and also more expensive. So, but that's important thing is it's not necessarily the more you polish, the better it is. It is your different style. So, you know, the one we had, some of, as I said, it's a kind of big flavor, big bodied. That is something which is not usually, not really polished down which goes with a rich food. But when you really polish and refine sake, which brings more flavor, and not only that, more floral. So, you know, if you really want to enjoy the aroma like a wine, you should choose the one which is high, low polished, like a 7%, as you said.
Thank you for your question. Thank you very much. Do we have any more? We do. We have someone over here on the far end. I can just see you. If you keep your hands up, please. Thank you very much for the microphone to arrive for you. Thank you.
I'm just curious, what kind of rice makes a good sake rice? And how do you kind of identify good sake rice versus average? Like, what's the difference between like sushi rice and sake rice?
So as I say, the starch is located in the center of sake rice. But starch is really not that tasty, is it, for us? It becomes quite powdery. So for eating rice, they're trying to make the more protein and fat. Because we love protein fat, do we? We like the fatty meat and things like that. So when the farmer is trying to make eating rice, the focus is to grow more protein fat. And then sake rice is the concentration of the starch in the center of sake rice. So that is the good sake rice. And it's a little larger as well, and about 30% larger than the regular eating rice. And then also 30% more expensive than regular eating rice, because to grow such a specific rice, the farmers has to know exactly how to make it. But not only that, they need more space for each stem. So the each stem has to have a much longer roots to support the top, because the normally the sake rice grows up to about 90 centimeters. And eating rice is maybe 70 centimeters. So that is a very different length. That means they can grow more eating rice in one little space. So.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Mm-hmm. We have actually a question online, and I think this will
really?
Be for you, Yoshitaka-san.
Not from Japan, okay, hybrid.
This is from Gemma. She says, I love the idea of film tourism. Do you see this increasing in Tohoku? And do you think this will help really expand awareness of Tohoku's sake overseas?
I'm hoping so. I'm involved in the project together with the company called In and Out. Yes, film tourism. It is not only for sake, but it's, as you know, it's that is the idea of supporting the devastated area or somebody who has a problem. And I noticed, especially like British people, they're rather than just go there and having a good time, they really like to do something. They are really active people to be the part of the, you know, community. And I really hope that it will be working, and it actually has a lot of examples which helped the other society, and I'm sure it will help the Tohoku, because Tohoku needs still help, you know, in many ways. So thank you, Gemma. I'm sure it will be a good idea to improve the film tourism.
Thank you, Yoshitaka-san. We have another question from Zoom as well, and maybe I can ask you, Tasaka-san, as well. This is from William. How can we tell those sake which should be served cold and those which could be served warm?
So my philosophy, okay, is all the sake can be drunk cold and warm or room temperature, and 10 different kinds of temperature can be enjoyed in sake. So if you buy a bottle of sake having only one temperature, such a waste, you're missing out so much. So at least you should try cold and room temperature at your home or restaurant. And there's only two types of sake that I don't recommend. And one really particularly is the sparkling sake. So if the sake is sparkling, keep it sparkle. So if you warm it up, those sparkle will go away. So I think sparkling sake is not really recommended. Warming, and also unpasteurized sake. If the sake is unpasteurized, normally the sake is pasteurized. There is no sulfite in sake. There is no preservative in the sake. So that means the to keep preserve the sake, what we do is cook in the brewery at 60 degrees, 62 degrees particularly. So if the sake is not cooked in the brewery, I think you should not cook it here. It came here as unpasteurized, not being cooked. Then why would you cook? So there are some sake that can be enjoy warm unpasteurized sake, but most of the time, I recommend keep it raw. Unpasteurized in Japanese means nama. Nama means raw. So if you have a sashimi, you wouldn't cook at home, would you? So that's my recommendation. And also maybe some fruity sake is not too suitable because the fruitiness is more noticeable at low temperature. If the sake has more umami, the rich, full flavor, but there's so many kinds of fruity sake. I warmed it, I enjoyed it. So don't close-minded to anything. Just to drink and try and see.
Simon, may I just add this? Something because it's a something very important subject. Because sake is perhaps the only alcohol you can drink at a different temperature. So what happens by warming up is, you can imagine you warm up the Coca-Cola. When you warm up, it brings a kind of sweetness. So if you feel like you need a little bit sweetness, you can warm up. And also, it reduces the kind of bitterness in the sake. And do you remember, maybe you are too young, but it's in overseas, many sake are provided, served very warm, not cold. Because sometimes when sake is kind of aged or deteriorated, it can, in a good way, disguise the faultiness as well. So when you started feeling like a sake has been opened too long, or you need a little bit something, you warm it up, then you might have another pleasure to bring up.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for. I'm sure if you do have any questions, both Tasaka-san and Yoshitake-san will be around for a little bit later on. For those of you in the room, we might even be able to have a little tasting again. I'm not so sure. I'm looking over there. So thank you very much indeed. Before I ask you to stand up, because there's some things will come up behind you. If you'd like to listen to this talk again, the recording of the event will be archived on Japan House London's YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter platforms. And for following today's event, you will all be sent a short feedback form by email. We ask you to fill in that, as it will help us to make these events in the future. Our current and upcoming displays, if I would like to be able to show you, this is, of course, a part of Tohoku 311 Forward to the Future. This runs until Sunday. And so tomorrow we have a talk, live link with Japan Regional Revitalization through education in Tohoku, building sustainable communities. And then on Sunday, we have social enterprise in Tohoku, Smart Strawberries. Please do feel free to join us online if you do so wish. Thank you very much. That concludes today's event. Would you please join me in thanking both Tasaka-san and Yoshitake-san. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having joined us. And thank you to everybody here in the room and also online. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you.